Good morning, and thank you for coming. I think I consider this the largest press briefing I have ever done in my 30 years of government service. And as we normally do at press briefings here at the State Department, we say that we have a few opening comments before we take your questions. So, you know, this morning I have a few opening comments before turning to your questions. It's truly an honor to participate in this event, obviously named in honor of Edward R. Murrow, one of the pioneers of modern television journalism. In this country, he is well known for his vivid radio reporting of the Second World War, which always began with his signature line, "This is London calling." For most Americans, he provided a window into a devastating war that challenged the civilized world like none before, and thankfully, like none since. Later, as television gained in prominence and power, he was the force behind a television program called See It Now. And he ended these broadcasts with a phrase, "Good night and good luck," you know, which, not surprisingly, became the title of a movie about the most famous episode of his distinguished journalist career, when he challenged what he saw as abuse of government power by then Senator Joseph McCarthy. In the annals of modern American journalism, his only competition in exposing the most serious abuse of power by government officials in modern times is the man who will follow me to this stage, Bob Woodward. For us in the United States, McCarthyism in the 1950s and Watergate in the 1970s brought out the worst in government and brought out the best in our journalists in this country. It set a strong example of the vital role that free, vibrant, and responsible media play in creating and sustaining a civil society. Two essential elements of the free flow of information, or two essential elements of civil society are the free flow of information and a government that is subject to checks and balances, a government that answers to and promotes the interests of the many rather than the few. In a recent speech, Secretary of State Hillary Clinton called government corruption around the world an epidemic that undermines stability and prosperity and erodes the fabric of society in too many countries. It is up to a free press to identify that corruption, to report that corruption, and force government to confront and correct that corruption. In this country, we call the media the fourth estate, a pillar of democratic society alongside the executive branch, the legislative branch, and an independent judiciary. Now, that doesn't mean that you will be admired for what you do. In this country, journalists have a lot in common with members of Congress. As individuals, they are frequently admired and have achieved, in many cases, celebrity status. But as an institution, public opinion of the media has been declining for many, many years, well, ever since Watergate. Now, Secretary Clinton, again, in a speech in July before the Council on Foreign Relations, encapsulated our foreign policy this way. She said, you know, "We, the United States, want to support and encourage democratic governments that protect the rights and deliver results for their people." Now, we in the United States, we have been called a hyperpower. We have been called hypocritical in the recent past. But in the context of promoting the free press, I think we do truly lead by example. We have the strongest and most enduring democracy in the world. One of the reasons for that is, on most days, the American people know more about their government, probably, than they want to know. Now, in roughly 4 hours' time, I will step to a podium like this one, one floor above us, and answer questions posed by your colleagues who cover the State Department every single day. But because we do this here, day in and day out, it provides us leverage to tell, for example, Hugo Chavez, as the Secretary of State did in July, that genuine democracy demands the promotion of, not the intimidation of, a free and vibrant press. It provides us the moral authority to challenge the Iranian government, where in the aftermath of the recent election in that country, it chose to suppress rather than enable the flow of information. You can tell a lot about a country by the way it treats its journalists and whether it accepts its responsibility to provide meaningful information to the public through members of the media about the actions and performance of government. Ultimately, no nation will be successful if it does not trust its people with the truth. The days where governments retain power by controlling information are coming to an end. We hope to help build a knowledge-based world where information empowers people to hold government to account. Information ultimately makes societies more democratic. The advance of technology in the 21st century creates both challenges and opportunities. The media in this country are struggling to find a business model that is actually sustainable. I think you heard a little bit about that yesterday. Technology has the potential to put more information in the hands of more individuals, which can empower people like never before. And this interconnectedness that technology provides gives voice and prominence to views that might have been ignored or marginalized in the past. But the media has responsibilities as well to report information fairly, honestly, and completely, providing the basic facts upon which a vigorous and civil debate can ensue. In my mind, the guiding principle must be to promote a civil society that is inclusive. Always be wary of anyone who suggests that they have a monopoly on the truth. Rather, use your position and your skills to advance a range of views and advance that vigorous debate in your own countries and your own societies. And we hope and we will be with you as you work to promote in your own countries, hopefully, a more responsible government, and as we aspire to in this country, a more perfect union. With those opening comments, I'm now happy to take your questions.